Unless you're new to my channel, you've probably heard me say this 100 times. Spoken French isn't simply written French said out loud. Written French is the one that you learned in school 30, 40, maybe 50 years ago. It's the correct formal French. But you can't speak French the way that you read French. This correct French doesn't exist in everyday life. Well, you can speak the formal correct written French, but you will sound a bit robotic, stiff, and way too formal. Kind of like if you were to speak English like Shakespeare. Even if this is not new information for you, it can be hard to understand what this looks like in practice, in real life. So today, let's take an online walk together in Paris. I will show you some cultural elements of the city, as well as plenty of specific examples where spoken French is different from the written formal French that you learned in school. First, let's see an example of correct French, the one that you would use in an exam or write in an essay, not the one that you will find in a TV show, a movie, or any kind of real everyday spoken French conversation. It's a presentation with the grammar and vocabulary of written French, the one that you learned at school decades ago. It's just as a test to show you the difference. Listen to it and think, what can you predict that will change in informal spoken French? J'aime bien me promener dans Paris. Il n'y a pas de meilleure façon de profiter de la capitale. Je prends le temps de marcher sur les boulevards, le long des immeubles haussmanniens et des pistes cyclables. Je me laisse distraire par les vitrines des grands magasins de mode. Les affiches des colonnes Maurice donnent envie d'aller voir des films et des pièces de théâtre. Je me perds dans la foule des passants pressés, souvent élégants. Ils sortent d'une station de métro marquée par une arche verte de style Art Nouveau. Aux terrasses des cafés, des jeunes Parisiens et Parisiennes discutent entre les bruits de la ville. Je n'entends que des bribes de conversation rapides et passionnées. Une odeur de croissant chaud me fait pousser la porte d'une boulangerie. J'y achète quelque chose comme une pâtisserie ou une demi-baguette croustillante encore chaude. Je la déguste dans un parc, sur un banc au calme, à l'ombre d'une statue du 19e siècle. Il y a une fontaine Wallace, j'y remplis ma gourde avant de continuer ma promenade. Je passe devant les restaurants, les pharmacies, les magasins bio. Je m'arrête devant une petite librairie de quartier. Je ne peux pas m'empêcher d'y entrer quelques minutes pour simplement profiter de l'atmosphère feutrée. Un peu plus loin, je tombe sur un bâtiment majestueux, une vieille église à colonnes. Au fur et à mesure, les noms des rues défilent sur les plaques bleues. J'arrive sur les bords de la Seine, les bateaux-mouches défilent sur le fleuve, sur les quais s'alignent les grandes boîtes vertes des bouquinistes. Des voyageurs y achètent une affiche et des cartes postales. Je termine ma promenade sur le parvis de Notre-Dame, couverte d'échafaudages pour sa reconstruction. Le monument est toujours magnifique, et témoigne fièrement de la richesse du patrimoine de la ville lumière. Yeah! Félicitations! Did you follow along? How much could you understand and how much did you need the subtitles? That was the correct version of the tour, the one you would use in an essay or in an oral exam in high school or in uni, the French that you learned in school 30, 40, maybe 50 years ago. But you would never hear that in a TV show like 10%, in a movie like Amélie Poulain, or in any real conversation in Paris or anywhere else in France. Spoken French can sound very, very different. And I know it's unsettling when you hear it. Of course, the main difference is that we would not have such a monologue in the first place. It would be a back and forth conversation with frequent reminders like tu vois.
Un peu, mais finalement pas tellement, tu vois.
Did you hear it? In the extract, she said tu vois. She adds a tag to make her sentence a back and forth conversation. Listen again.
Un peu, mais finalement pas tellement, tu vois.
And that is why working on real sounding dialogues is so important, because this is what a language is made of. And this is why I include real sounding dialogues in my programs, like the 30 Day French Challenge. This one is a full month program with me and your fellow French learners, where you will learn about French culture and French language in a fun way, a little bit every day. There's a new one coming up very soon, just click on the link below this video. Now, let's see how we can turn this formal presentation with the kind of French you're familiar with into everyday spoken French, so that you can learn and see the difference and practice your spoken French as it is actually used in France. How much could you understand it? On the other hand, spoken French is easier with simpler grammar and vocabulary. But on the other hand, you still have to learn some colloquial expressions. And yes, we speak a lot faster, but you can make it, I'm absolutely sure of it. Here are some tricks that you will hear in the spoken French presentation. One trick we use is eating letters. We eat the E everywhere. Je becomes J apostrophe, le becomes L apostrophe, D becomes D apostrophe, even before a consonant. It's crazy! An example from the presentation. Je prends le temps de marcher sur les boulevards. I take the time to walk along the boulevard. It will become je prends le temps de marcher sur les boulevards. Because the E in je, in le, in de disappear. I'm going to say this again. Je prends le temps de marcher sur les boulevards. This is what you will hear in everyday spoken French. We also eat the il form. We don't say il, we say I. Ils sont souvent pressés will become in the spoken French presentation. Ils sont souvent pressés, with the L and the S actually becoming silent. Ils sont souvent pressés, they're often in a hurry. Ils sont souvent pressés is what you will hear in your favorite TV show, in your favorite movie, and in everyday conversations that you will have in France and with French people in general. And with this trick, there is a little twist, because the liaison is going to stay. Ah, I know, French is difficult. Ils ont faim becomes ils ont faim. The L is silent, but the S still sounds like a Z before a consonant. They're hungry. Ils ont faim. Ils ont faim. And if you don't know that, it's going to be really difficult to give them some food. We also eat the N in negation. I've said that like a billion times on Commune Française already, I know. Je ne peux pas m'empêcher d'y entrer. We wouldn't say that in everyday life. We would say, je peux pas m'empêcher d'y entrer. This is spoken French for you. This is not the French that you learned at school. Je peux pas m'empêcher d'y entrer. I can't help but step inside. Je peux pas m'empêcher d'y entrer. The ne has disappeared. Then the il y a becomes ya. Il y a une fontaine Wallace. Perfect for an exam, a written essay. But in everyday life, we would say « y'a une fontaine Wallace ». And this is what you will hear in France. « Y'a une fontaine Wallace ». There is a Wallace fountain. « Y'a une fontaine Wallace ». And very often they combine, because speech is not an exercise from your textbook. It's real life. « Il n'y a pas de meilleure façon de profiter de la capitale. » Perfect for a written essay to get an A. But we would never say that. We would say, y'a pas de meilleure façon de profiter de la capitale. There's no better way to experience the capital. And this is where you have to work. Y'a pas de meilleure façon de profiter de la capitale. Work on your ear to actually hear what I am saying and understand everyday spoken French. And Commune Française specializes in this area of French to help you get from this written form of French you learned at school to French that you can actually use to understand and be understood. Y'a pas de meilleure façon de profiter de la capitale. I know that's difficult. And finally, vocabulary, like se promener, perfect. But we would say as well, se balader, for to walk around, to stroll. Se balader. Then une promenade as well would become une balade, which is a nice walk. Balade is not slang in any way, but it's more common than promenade in spoken French. And of course, there is more vocabulary differences. Can you notice them yourself? You are going to listen to the spoken French version of the presentation now. The kind of French you need to understand TV shows, movies, and everyday French conversations. And that is going to really help you speak more authentically and like a grown-up. Try to hear the difference that we've just seen and notice what else has changed. C'est parti. J'aime bien balader dans Paris. Il n'y a pas de meilleure façon de profiter de la capitale. Je prends le temps de marcher sur les boulevards, tu vois, le long des immeubles haussmanniens et des pistes cyclables. Je me laisse distraire par les vitrines des grands magasins de mode. Les affiches des colonnes Maurice donnent envie d'aller voir des films et des pièces de théâtre. Je me perds dans la foule des passants. Ils sont souvent pressés et bien sapés aussi. Ils sortent d'une station de métro avec une arche verte Art Nouveau. Aux terrasses des cafés, des jeunes Parisiens et Parisiennes discutent entre les bruits de la ville. J'entends que des bouts de conversation rapides et passionnés. Une odeur de croissant chaud me fait pousser la porte d'une boulangerie. J'y achète un truc, genre une pâtisserie ou une demi-baguette croustillante encore chaude. Je la mange dans un parc, sur un banc au calme, à l'ombre d'une statue du 19e siècle. Il y a une fontaine Wallace, j'y remplis ma gourde avant de continuer ma balade. Je passe devant les restos, les pharmacies, les magasins bio. Je m'arrête devant une petite librairie de quartier. Je peux pas m'empêcher d'y entrer quelques minutes, juste pour profiter de l'atmosphère. Un peu plus loin, je tombe sur un bâtiment stylé, une vieille église à colonnes. Au fur et à mesure, les noms des rues défilent sur des plaques bleues. J'arrive sur les bords de la Seine, les bateaux mouches défilent sur le fleuve. Sur les quais, il y a les grandes boîtes vertes des bouquinistes. Des voyageurs y achètent une affiche et des cartes postales. Je termine ma balade sur le parvis de Notre-Dame, couverte d'échafaudages pour sa reconstruction. Le monument est toujours magnifique et témoigne fièrement de la richesse du patrimoine de Paris. Yeah, félicitations! That was hard, wasn't it? Could you hear all the times that I skipped an It's very common in real French. What else did you notice? For instance, instead of élégant, I said bien sapé for well-dressed. It's colloquial. It's a bit more youth French, but it's important to understand it because it will be used in everyday French like 10%, engrenage or Lupin. Even though maybe you wouldn't use it. I want to say something about youth French. Very often students tell me, yeah, but that's youth French, I'm not going to use that. It's okay, it's absolutely fine. But I have to remind you that sometimes youth French has been around for 30, 40, 50, maybe 100 years. So it's not an invention of the youth of today at all. Sapé, for example, has been around for a very long time. But you're absolutely welcome not to use it. I didn't say un restaurant, I said un resto, because in everyday French, we shorten the words, and that, everybody does it. Quelque chose became un truc. Un truc is extremely useful in everyday spoken French to say something. It's colloquial for a thingy or a thing in English. Un truc with this U sound. Un truc. Un truc. Comme became genre. That, again, is everyday spoken French, something that maybe my parents wouldn't use, but it's not vulgar or rude in any way. Genre is not vulgar, it means gender as well, but like this, for comme, we say genre instead, it means kind of. Remember? Did you hear that in the presentation? Instead of saying j'y achète quelque chose, comme une pâtisserie, ou une demi-baguette, I said, j'y achète un truc, genre une pâtisserie ou une demi-baguette. I buy something there like a pastry or half a baguette. And the written version of the presentation, the formal one, has some poetry that sounds too formal in everyday French. It's beautiful, but we wouldn't speak like this and you wouldn't hear this in everyday spoken French. Sur les quais s'alignent les bouquinistes. That's fantastic. It's a new version, subject, verb. It's a bit formal, and it's also the case in question. I made a lesson about this recently. In everyday spoken French, you would hear, sur les quais, y a des bouquinistes, because the il y a would become ya, ya, ya. Sur les quais, y a des bouquinistes. This is what you would hear in TV shows, in movies, and in everyday spoken French. I also changed some vocabulary. For example, majestueux became stylé for majestic, stylish. It's a bit of slang, kind of youth French for this one, I have to be honest. une bribe became un bout with a silent T. Un bout, un bout. For a snippet or a small piece. Un bout, un bout. Je la déguste became je la mange. I savor it for la, je la déguste is a bit too formal. We would say je la mange. I eat it. Je la mange with the nasal en. Je la mange. And then, la ville lumière, fantastic for an essay, became Paris. We say Paris. The city of light is fantastic. It's a beautiful nickname of Paris. Great for your presentation, your essay, any kind of French thing where you have to be graded. But we never ever use this in everyday spoken French. We say Paris and that's good. And let's listen to the presentation one last time, okay? Don't freak out, it's okay. You will get all the subtitles and then we'll have some quick practice together. Remember what we've seen. We saw that there are some eaten letters like the E. We skip the N in negations. The il y a becomes ya. And we have vocabulary differences like un truc instead of quelque chose. Ready? It's okay. We're in the safe space together. C'est parti. J'aime bien me balader dans Paris. Il n'y a pas de meilleure façon de profiter de la capitale. Je prends le temps de marcher sur les boulevards, tu vois, le long des immeubles haussmanniens et des pistes cyclables. Je me laisse distraire par les vitrines des grands magasins de mode. Les affiches des colonnes Maurice donnent envie d'aller voir des films et des pièces de théâtre. Je me perds dans la foule des passants. Ils sont souvent pressés et bien sapés aussi. Ils sortent d'une station de métro avec une arche verte Art Nouveau. Aux terrasses des cafés, des jeunes parisiens et parisiennes discutent entre les bruits de la ville. J'entends que des bouts de conversation rapides et passionnés. Une odeur de croissant chaud me fait pousser la porte d'une boulangerie. J'y achète un truc, genre une pâtisserie ou une demi-baguette croustillante encore chaude. Je la mange dans un parc, sur un banc au calme, à l'ombre d'une statue du 19e siècle. Il y a une fontaine Wallace, j'y remplis ma gourde avant de continuer ma balade. Je passe devant les restos, les pharmacies, les magasins bio. Je m'arrête devant une petite librairie de quartier. Je peux pas m'empêcher d'y entrer quelques minutes, juste pour profiter de l'atmosphère. Un peu plus loin, je tombe sur un bâtiment stylé, une vieille église à colonnes. Au fur et à mesure, les noms des rues défilent sur des plaques bleues. J'arrive sur les bords de la Seine, les bateaux mouches défilent sur le fleuve. Sur les quais, il y a les grandes boîtes vertes des bouquinistes. Des voyageurs y achètent une affiche et des cartes postales. Je termine ma balade sur le parvis de Notre-Dame, couverte d'échafaudages pour sa reconstruction. Le monument est toujours magnifique et témoigne fièrement de la richesse du patrimoine de Paris. How did that go? Ooh, it's not easy, right? But we are here together to help you improve your understanding of everyday spoken French. Turn these three correct sentences into informal French. Can you do it? Je mangerais bien quelque chose. I'd like to eat something. Il n'y a pas de problème. For no problem. There's no problem. Ils n'ont jamais vu Amélie Poulain. They've never seen the movie Amélie. Remember what we've seen together, okay? I'm going to give you 5 seconds now to think before the big reveal. Did you get it? It would be je mangerais bien un truc instead of je mangerais bien quelque chose. Then we have y'a pas de problème. The il n'y a becomes y'a. We skip the ne in the negation. We don't say il n'y a pas de problème. And then I eat the ne in de. Y'a pas de problème instead of il n'y a pas de problème. The last one is « Ils ont jamais vu Amélie Poulain ». We have the silent L in « il ». I say « ils ont ». I do la liaison anyway. I don't say « ils ont jamais vu ». I say « ils ont jamais vu ». And I skip the « ne ». So « ils n'ont jamais vu Amélie Poulain » becomes « ils ont jamais vu Amélie Poulain ». And this is what you would hear in an everyday spoken French sentence, in a dialogue, in a movie, in a TV show, someone speaking to you, they would say, ils ont jamais vu Amélie Poulain. So this is why you have to concentrate on spoken French in order to learn it as a different language. That's it for today. Félicitations. We have reached the end of your practice together today. Well done you, that wasn't easy. And we have covered a lot of ground. You can rewatch this video if you think you have missed anything, or you can dive deeper into the rules of everyday spoken French by simply clicking on your screen right here. You will get your next video lesson where I tell you more about understanding spoken French. And you saw how difficult that is, so I am here to help you do that. A tout de suite, I will see you in the next video. Salut!